there really isn't a more beautiful planet through a small telescope than Saturn. Earth would give it a run for its money if you were living on a lunar colony, looking back at home, but as far as we see down here, Saturn probably wins it, at least for me. And I can appreciate all the planets, of course, through the telescope, even though Neptune and Uranus in a small telescope are just tiny featureless disks. But with color evocative of what Voyager 2 saw, at those worlds up close. Uranus and Neptune were unknown until the last few centuries, but Saturn, we knew that one since time immemorial, and the rings since Galileo, who in his primitive telescope saw them as lobes. But today you can see the rings clearly and brightly with binoculars, and it is the jewel of the solar system from our perspective in amateur astronomy. And what makes it so beautiful is the extensive ring system. But ring systems aren't rare. All the large planets have them to varying degrees, and they can get much, much more extensive than anything we have here. And it's a weird story. Indeed, this video is chock full of weird stories. The object was known as J1407b, and it very much mystified astronomers initially because it appeared to eclipse the star V1400 Centauri in a very extensive, very strange way. Think as strange as Tabby Star for longtime listeners to this channel. Whatever was going on there did not appear normal, or like anything previously seen. It turned out to be a large exoplanet or brown dwarf with a ring system over 200 times more extensive than that of Saturn. But here's the weird thing about how that story developed in more recent years. It seems that the object with the rings isn't actually orbiting that star, but just happened to be passing by right when we were looking. In other words, a rogue object of unknown origin, free-floating in space. Perhaps long ago ejected from a star system that either had or has acquired an extensive ring system somehow. Perhaps by ripping apart a moon, or capturing something in deep space and tearing it to shreds. Yet the divisions observed in that ring system seem to suggest herding by exomoons, hints of exomoons. Very interesting system indeed. The thing is, while our terrestrial worlds do not have ring systems currently, nothing physically prevents a planet like Earth from having one, especially if it's transient and only around for a few million years. And there may be evidence that at one point Earth did in fact have a ring system, and it actually was not a very placid or peaceful Saturn-like situation apparently, at least at the end. Rather, it was always a ticking time bomb, just perhaps a very pretty one for a time. So the story seems to have started around 466 million years ago. The Earth may have had a near miss with an asteroid that might have torn it apart, and given the Earth a ring system that would have persisted for a few tens of millions of years. The thing is here is that the evidence pointing towards this is also simultaneously suggesting several problems Earth weathered in its past. Most severe of these is simple, the ring fell on us. There is an event known as the Ordovician impact spike that occurred about 466 million years ago, where Earth seems to have seen an increased rate of impact events. When researchers from Monash University in Australia looked at impact features known from this event and took into account continental drift, they found that the impacts lined up in such a way as to be consistent with objects from a ring system around Earth being gradually pulled down from orbit in order to impact and form a line of craters on Earth at different times, but all related, like a gradually falling ring. This is not good. Cratering events on Earth of any size or frequency are extremely bad, as the dinosaurs well know. This series of events was backed up by limestone deposits that were being laid down near the equator at this time that bore increasing chemical evidence of large-scale meteorite impacts and general falling material. This is not at all likely from random meteorite and asteroid strikes. Indeed, no corresponding rise of impact events seems to have happened anywhere else in the solar system at this time. If there had been a hail of comets moving through, for example, we should see evidence of that all around the solar system. But not this. This only happened to Earth during this very specific time period, so far as we yet know. And that may only have been explainable via a decaying ring system. That's not settled, however. there is another idea, more on that in a bit, and it's even stranger. The question is, what else did this do other than to potentially create a spectacular ring system, ostensibly visible from the surface of the Earth for a time, to the Ordovician fauna's uninterested eyes, only later to affect them with craters, you ask? This is a new mystery that's actually related to an old mystery. There really isn't a good handle on what kind of light blocking effect a ring system around Earth could have had, but if it was strong enough, it could have altered the climate for the few million years it existed. It turns out that the Ordovician did have just such a cold snap. To get deeper into it, the Ordovician meteor event period is evidenced by an increase in L-type chondrite meteorites evident in the geological record. This is a weird story in itself, and actually represents a double mystery, in that part remains completely unsolved in meteorite studies. No one really knows what's going on in this case. So the evidence for the chondrites, in part, comes from a quarry in Sweden, known as Thorsberg Limestone Quarry. This is one of the most meteorite-dense areas on Earth, and the meteorites are suspended in the limestone, like dinosaur bone fossils. It really is similar to that. And the way it is arranged has no right to be that way, unless something really strange and situational happened. Basically, the meteorites fell during the early to mid Ordovician, and represent at least 12 different meteorite falls at different times, yet a very similar material, all over what was then the seafloor, all in a 6,000 square meter area. That's a really small area, and most explanations for it, other than maybe the ring, seem implausible. It really is a whole lot of meteorite falls, over a long period of time, of very similar material, that is not in keeping with how meteorites fall and classify today. This is detailed in a paper by Thomas Muller, link in the description below, and details that the 12 separate falls stretch over a period of about 1.75 million years, during the Ordovician, and represent L-chondrites, suggesting an influx of this type of meteoritic material, probably all from the same parent asteroid, at this time leading to a higher bombardment of the Earth. Fair enough, an asteroid gets destroyed, its fragments are all similar, and they fall over a period of time. Seems fully plausible, but remember, not the rest of the solar system saw this, so far as we know. That could change, but right now it appears that it only did this on Earth, incomplete as our understanding of meteorite falls and the other terrestrial planets and moons is. This might lend evidence for a ring in that it might just be the simplest answer in this weird set of evidence. Incidentally, this also lends credence to the idea that one can recover meteorites from the ocean floor, a somewhat contentious topic these days with the interstellar meteorite claimed recovery off of the coast of Papua New Guinea. The main objection that was initially published was that you could never recover a meteorite from the ocean floor. Well, that was actually never true. Recovering meteorites from the ocean has always happened. From the recovery of the Cape York iron meteorites from the coastal waters of Greenland, and the fact that indigenous peoples had been picking pieces of its iron out of the water without magnets or metal detectors and hammering them into harpoon points for hundreds or thousands of years, to the NOAA recovering fragments of what appear to be chondritic spherules in the National Olympic Marine Sanctuary well before the IM-1 expedition by Loeb and Siraj. It shows that yes, you can recover a rock from space from the ocean floor. And not only can you do that, the ocean floor can turn into limestone and preserve at least some evidence of a fossil meteorite for over 400 million years, like a dinosaur bone. Oceans do not suddenly vaporize meteorites when they fall into them. Whether some spherules could be linked to a meteoritic origin or an interstellar meteoritic origin is another matter, but proof of concept was already there. And the idea of a meteorite traveling through interstellar space and occasionally hitting Earth is nothing close to implausible. It almost certainly happens. How often remains to be seen. But it has to be said that the ocean does contain a lot of unusual materials originating from us that might mimic a meteoritic spherule. The Swedish fossil meteorites are established legitimate fossil meteorites, without question, but also hidden within the Swedish quarry is a second mystery. Before we get to that, there actually is additional corroborating evidence of an increase in meteorite influx on Earth during the Middle Ordovician. There are also enhanced chromite grains, of a type linked to ordinary L-type chondrites, separately in the geologic record from this time. In fairness, it must be noted that the other potential explanation is that it has been suggested that this may well all have been caused in a breakup of an L-type chondrite parent body in the asteroid belt. It only seemed to have affected Earth, so far as is currently known. This material should be on Mars too, and it pays to remember that if someone does a study and finds that yes indeed, the rest of the solar system shows evidence of this breakup as well, then the Earth ring system idea may lose steam. But here's the strange thing. The Swedish quarry actually yielded an anomaly, another meteorite from this period that was not an L-type chondrite. And indeed, it's the only one of its type ever found. And this type of meteorite does not appear to fall on Earth, so far as we know today. Only during the Ordovician period, and it's very weird. The meteorite fossil is known as Osterplana 065, and was found in the Thorsberg quarry in 2011. It impacted Earth 470 million years ago during the Ordovician, and it fits into no meteorite classification we currently have. Not really even all that close to anything we have, leading to a hypothesis that the parent body is extinct, and there no longer is enough of a population of fragments of it to still be falling to Earth. An alternative might be to see if it was never from here in the first place, and whether it could in fact have been of interstellar origin. Indeed, the best description anyone's come up with is Winonate-like, which is a very rare type of meteorite named after a meteorite that was found under interesting circumstances near Winona, Arizona in 1928. It was actually found in an archaeological dig at a site where the Sinagua people had settled between about the year 1150 up to 1275. It was found in a cist that was probably a grave, suggesting that it was a prized object when it was found. They knew it was odd and became a grave good. Sadly, the meteorite was badly weathered by the time it was excavated and fell apart, and remained more or less unclassified until it was later found to be a completely new type of very primitive yet heat-altered asteroid material. The thing is the Winonate group of meteorites, there are now 54 known examples of other falls of similar material, along with two types of iron meteorites also associated, and all appear to be from the same asteroid parent body. With the Winonate-like Osterplana 065, it doesn't fit this parent body, because the isotope ratios are off. It's just somewhat geologically like it. Way off from any other meteorite ever found. It just looks like a Winonate type because of the partial melting and overall primitive character. With chromium-54, it looks just like an ordinary chondrite. Just a meteorite that accreted out of the chondrules of the solar nebula. The grains that originally made up the rock of the solar system. With the oxygen isotopes, however, it looks like a primitive and volcanic achondrite, a different type of meteorite structure. A hybrid, okay, a partly melted chondrite, basically, except this also comes along with minerals that occur in no other meteorites in our collections, related to chromium, spinel, and rutile. That mineralogy remains anomalous. In other words, this meteorite remnant is unique, and whatever its origin was, far and wide or outside the solar system, these do not appear to fall here any longer, and no other examples of this meteorite type are known. There's just nothing else like it we have, and we don't see them falling. They don't make them like this anymore for whatever reason, but there really isn't a readily evident reason. Maybe it might have a more interesting origin than was previously thought. There are very few cases of truly anomalous meteorites in our collections. There usually is always a similar one from a different fall, except here. If the parent body of Osterplana 065 was involved in the destruction of the normal L-chondrite Ordovician parent body that may or may not have formed a ring around Earth of mixed material from the two objects, or may or may not have collided with an asteroid in the main belt and sprayed out here, it is anomalous to what we know of in the current solar system, and caused an anomalous event here on Earth. That can mean many things potentially. That whatever it was rare in the solar system to begin with, and we shouldn't expect to see material like this much. Or it was an interstellar interloper, or it was a fluke, or the preservation in the quarry introduced something that was not quite right. This meteorite is very old and literally fossilized to a degree, but it's interesting nonetheless, and related to a relatively poorly understood period during the Ordovician that we don't really have much of a handle on, where something catastrophic, or at least planet-changing, appears to have happened. It's also worth noting that there was also a great biodiversification event during this period that may coincide, that appears to have happened during this period that we don't understand. But could it be related to the influx of meteorites? We don't yet know. A very strange rabbit hole indeed. Even I didn't know how deep it was until I deep dove into the research. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently worried about Earth's formerly gorgeous ring system that now only exists as a line of craters and a rock deposit. That wasn't a good end. And I mentioned the uninterested Ordovician eyes. The hubris of the trilobites knows no bounds. Well, they get a pass. Kind of hard to see a ring system from the ocean floor. Would have seen the falling meteorites hitting the bottom though. Crunch. Don't even get me on the topic of the hubris of the brachiopods. Doppelgangers of clams, the lot of them. Or is it vice versa? Clam experts, tell me your thoughts in the comments. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.